One. Hello everybody, my name's Jason. Today I'm making a video based on addiction and witchcraft. So, what you're going to learn in this video is how what we call today addiction is actually a form of witchcraft, and the street drugs that people use in their addiction is actually a true product of witchcraft, which is pure evil. And that should explain some things, why addicts do what they do. But also in this video, I'm going to explain a scripture based on my very own experience and how when an addict uses, gets clean, and always seems to go back to their addiction, only to relapse and become worse than they first was. I'm going to explain that in full detail and why that is, both on the physical side of things, which science understands for the most part, but what science doesn't understand is the spiritual part. I do from 3 spiritual experiences, 1 very bad. So you don't want to mess with this and it will lead you straight to hell. So I'm a victim of it, and that's how I know these things. I lived it for over a decade, my friends. So with all that being said, a disclaimer for this video, because I'm not going to sugarcoat nothing, I'm telling you straight up, take it or leave it, but I speak truth, okay? So if you're an addict, you might want to skip this first part, okay? And if you're struggling in addiction, then learn as much as you can from this video and know what you're up against, because most addicts don't have a clue what they're doing to themselves. And I'm going to explain all that spiritually and physically and how it works together to deceive us mankind. And we don't even know it. My friends, listen to this. I speak truth. Now, do not try this at home. Oh. And if you're not an addict and you're trying to save someone from their addiction, you're probably living hell on earth right now. I know. I did it to my people for over a decade. That's why I got out of it some time ago. And I'm going to tell you how to do that too. Cut in through the video to remind you that there is a way out of this doom. Yes. So to get started, I'm going to start with this. First, addiction, we're going to have to understand the drug. So addiction is a form of witchcraft. The drugs is the product of witchcraft, which is pure evil. So crack cocaine being mined for over a decade, this also includes crack cocaine, heroin, and meth. But I don't know about meth and heroin, because I never messed with that. It was crack cocaine mined, so I'm going to base it on that mainly. But it works for the other street drugs as well, the other two anyway, that I know of. So first of all, to perform witchcraft, if you want to go back to like ancient times, how witches and sorcerers did it, you would see like a pot like this, right? Okay, that's pretty much what's going on. And we're going to cook a product of witchcraft so we can have a product to cast a spell with, which is performing witchcraft. So 3 ingredients, very simple. I'm going to explain each one, okay? First of all, first ingredient is water. Okay, water, it's innocent by itself, it's a good thing, but misused, it could also be a bad thing. I mean, people can drown people in water, so that's a misuse of water. But by itself, drinking it, that's fine. But in this case, what we're going to do, we're casting an evil spell, y'all, product of witchcraft. This water is about to be evil as shit. You'll see why. So let's add that to the pot, right? All right. Second ingredient. This is very obvious, and you'll see where I'm going with this. Again, do not try this at home, because you will be in violation of God, and he won't burn you for that one. Anyway, cocaine, second ingredient, comes from a very potent and powerful plant. Cocaine actually can be used as a good thing. You can numb pains, like if you get a little cut and you rub some cocaine, it can numb the pain, okay? And it can be used as Novocaine and for medical uses. But if you put cocaine, this plant, it's a powerful plant, easily misused, but good can come from it. But you put this in the hands of mankind, people, we gonna destroy yourself. Ain't no one using this properly. They put it up their nose. That's misuse and that's evil. So cocaine, it could be a good thing, but for the most part, it's gonna doom us. That's why it's illegal. So don't do it. But we have to add that into the pot to get our product of witchcraft. Now, the final ingredient. Everyone got it in their fridge? Very simple. You chemical reactions. Not always in witchcraft, but in this case, that's how we're doing it. Baking soda is the final ingredient. And of course, baking soda is harmless, but using these three ingredients and mixing them a certain way in the intention to destroy mankind, that is the evil influences that power these things and give mankind the thoughts, ideas, and dreams to create such a product, is from the evil ones, spirits and demons, my friends. And I'll explain all that later. So, putting this together, oh, so let's put the baking soda down in the pot. And with the flames of hell, we're going to fire it up and cook that. Now, while that goes, okay, let me explain the product. We already know the end product, okay, that's going to come out of this. So, to make it more easier to understand how this is a product of witchcraft, comparing it real quick while that cooks, okay? I know. The more detail, the more you're going to understand this. So, watch it through the end. But the product of witchcraft that we're about to have is similar to what they would call Love Potion Number 9. It's an old school movie. Love Potion Number 9. It sounds sweet, loving. It sounds like a sweet, innocent thing, right? No, Love Potion Number 9 is pure evil. When you have Love Potion Number 9, which is a product of witchcraft, which is about something similar we're about to have, Love Potion Number 9 forces someone against their free will to fall in love with someone. That's a violation of our free will that God has given us, which violates God's will as well. It's pure evil and not to be tampered with. This is why Love Potion Number 9 is a form of witchcraft. And it's very similar to these street drugs, especially cocaine, crack cocaine. So it looks like we're done. So now we have our product, not Love Potion Number 9, but a rock. People, do not get excited. You do this shit, it's gonna put you in hell. This product of witchcraft, crack cocaine, the intention of it and the way it's created is to make mankind fall from the original source, which is the evil ones. Okay, they have very much knowledge of this. We barely have knowledge. We only know the physical. So I'm going to explain both physical and spiritual. So with this product of witchcraft, crack cocaine, if we perform witchcraft by making this product and we put this product and give it to someone and tell it, and they put it in them, we are casting a spell on that person. But the thing is, addicts are being deceived, and without even knowing it, when we get high on these products, we are casting spells on ourselves. That's exactly what's going on. That's the truth of it. We just call it addiction, but there's more to it than you think. So, by creating a product like this, putting it in us, we cast a spell on ourselves, which means we are performing witchcraft. When you perform witchcraft, you are entertaining evil spirits and opening up doorways to the spiritual realm for us to make contact of spiritual things and letting evil spiritual things within us. This is why it's forbidden by God, and he finds it to be an abomination messing with witchcraft. These drugs is just a product of witchcraft in disguise. It's a hidden trick of the evil ones, okay? Well, everyone knows it's bad, but it's worse because it's witchcraft. We just don't know. So, when someone puts this product in them, they're casting a spell on themselves. Then they come to the point where they do it and entertain this stuff so much, continuously performing witchcraft and casting spells on themselves over and over again. You already know how addicts are, me being one of them, that the more you do this, an addict will come to a certain point where they start to get paranoid. They start to think that someone's coming or they feel like they're being watched. People, the reason why when addicts get high and they think someone's watching them, that's because they are, okay? It's like every time a drug like this is being used, it's like playing on that Ouija board. The more you play on it and you actually get it to work, you are entertaining and summoning evil spirits, and you're opening up ways for spiritual evils to come in from the spiritual world into the physical. So we're affected not only biologically and through chemicals, also spiritual things are happening. So when someone's using these things, they are at a certain point, they're hooked like a fish because the biological physical part is it's putting chemicals in us, messing our minds up. Mind-altering substance is what this is doing, and that mind-altering substance is opening up ways to contact spiritual things, letting evils within our lives. This is why addicts continuously get worse and worse the more they use this product, because they continuously perform witchcraft and casting spells on themselves. So when someone feels like they're being watched, there's actually demons, evil spirits in the room watching you. And this is why addicts get that feeling, because they let those evil spirits in by performing witchcraft, by using the product of witchcraft. It's evil. So when you're at the point where you're paranoid, these demons are watching us, casting spells on ourselves like a bunch of dumbasses. They're probably laughing at us, watching us peek out windows, carpet surfing, all that other weird shit you see in a trap house. If you've been there, you know what I'm talking about. They're all over the place. That's what's going on. And so it makes you wonder, why can we not see these things? Well, first of all, let me say this. Once you get to the point of paranoia, that means they got you hooked like a fish. They got you hooked like a fish on a fishing rod. Don't think for a second, 6 months clean down the road from this, they don't still have you on that hook, because they do. I'm going to try to remember to bring that up again and how they bring you back. So never let your guard down if you get clean. So what I'm saying here is, these evil spirits, we cannot see them. So the reason why I think we cannot see them, before I continue on, just to explain this a little more, is because based on one of my out-of-body experiences, that seeing my very own soul is made out, our souls seem to be made out of light and energy. So by knowing that from my own experience, I'm assuming an evil spirit is made out of a light and energy as well. More like a dark light, but a light and energy. That is what I'm assuming based on what I seen when my soul was out of the body. So, with that being said, light is what we need to... Light is light and energy, okay? So, if you look at the light spectrum, okay, this is 100% of the light spectrum. Mankind, our eyes can only see 10% of this light. 10% of this light. But the other 90% of the light is completely invisible to the naked eye. So we can only see 10% of what's actually in front of us right now with the light. And all 100% of this light spectrum is in front of our face right now as I speak, and 24/7, 365. It's always there, always. So, to give you a good example to better understand this, the reason why we cannot see demons is the same reason why we cannot see our cell phone signals on our cell phones, right? So, if you have a cell phone, you can't see or touch your cell phone signal. And the reason why that is because wireless communication from our cell phones, they transfer information through the light spectrum. Specifically with our cell phones, the information transferred through these light spectrums is between radio waves and microwaves. Those are the completely invisible light spectrum to our eyes that we cannot see. And because cell phones use those light spectrums, we cannot see our cell phone signals. If we was able to see with the naked eye 100% of the light spectrum, we would see all these colors. You would see everyone's cell phone signal, and because everyone's connected, you would see it at all times. It's there at all times, but we cannot see 90% of it. We only see 10%, which is basically colors of the rainbow. Okay, so and this is why when people have a near-death experience of going to heaven and they come back and they try to explain colors they don't know how to explain, that's because some of those colors are hidden in 90% of the completely invisible light spectrum. Therefore, they only experience heaven for a moment's time. They didn't have enough time to comprehend or explain these colors. They never grew up with them. They seen them for a moment and they don't understand them. So that's why. Again, like the cell phone signal is a light and energy because it runs on the light spectrum. If evil spirits are a light and energy, as I'm assuming, based on me seeing my very own soul in an out-of-body experience, then if evil spirits are made out of light and energy, I'm thinking more of a dark light, that they could easily hide in the light spectrum right next to her cell phone or anywhere in the invisible light spectrum. They have 90% of the light spectrum to hide in if they're made of energy and light. But if they're not made out of light within the 10% of the spectrum we see, they would be completely invisible to us. So again, when somebody gets high into the paranoid state of they feel like they're being watched or someone's coming, that's because they're already there, my friends. They're watching us cast spells on ourselves with the product of witchcraft, crack cocaine, and other drugs. And they're just looking at us like a bunch of dumbasses, because nobody should cast a spell on themselves, people, or destroying ourselves. Anyway, that is why people get paranoid of the spiritual things. And the as far as the chemicals we're putting in us, it's altering our minds and biological things that is allowing our physical bodies in our souls to tap into spiritual things, which is an abomination to God and is forbidden for these reasons of witchcraft. It's evil. That's why God don't want us doing it. He makes these rules to stay away from it, to protect us from destroying ourselves. Just like addiction destroys themselves. An addict like me destroyed myself for over a decade. It'll land you to hell where I almost went. So let's talk about this. With all that being said, let me make sure I know I'm missing something here. So we're casting, okay, I did the love potion, the casting of spells, witchcraft, okay, this light spectrum. Okay, so to give you a better understanding of a modern day version of witchcraft, let's do this. And then I'm going to move on to the next thing. Okay, so first of all, in biblical times, or we'll say ancient times, like witchcraft as we know it, you would see a pot with a witch cooking up one of her little spells, right? Okay, so with that, that's old ancient stuff, right? That's how they did it back in the day, back in the day. How they do it today, they're upgraded, smarter, more potent, and hidden, okay? If you want to see this type of witchcraft, modern day technology of witchcraft, you would get this. This is a meth lab. I never mess with this stuff, but I know about it. It's the product. This is how witchcraft, the product of witchcraft, is created in modern day today. We call this a drug addiction if you use this stuff. This is the mixing of chemicals and basically from plants, because plants are a bunch of chemicals together, and such as when we cooked the spell we did a little earlier, the cocaine plant, it's chemicals. So you mix the right kind of chemicals with the intention to destroy one. That's part of what makes it witchcraft. I don't know exactly what makes these products witchcraft, but these definitely are witchcraft, and they will destroy you, kill you, rip your family apart, and make you regret everything you've ever done as you're on this shit. And you're hooked like a fish. Remember that part. So, with all that being said, that's your modern day witchcraft. Okay, and the people who make these things, mankind, they ain't got a clue this is witchcraft. To them, it's just a business. Just like a doctor, the doctor's office giving you pharmaceuticals, it's a business. They don't know no better. They only know the physical things of how to create these things. They don't know the spiritual things, the power and influence mankind to give us ideas to come up with such things to make. You will have more drugs in the future that will be more potent. They're always up to their tricks, the evil ones I speak of. When I say evil one, I ain't talking about people. I'm talking about evil spirits and demons, and perhaps fallen angels who know this stuff. Okay, so the thing is this. Where was I? Pretty sure I'm missing something, I feel. But either way, I'm just going to move on. So don't do this stuff. And that's pretty much for this one, and I'm going to move on to the scripture to explain the biological and spiritual things when someone gets clean, or someone uses, or they're in their addiction, they get clean, they go back, and why they always go back to their addiction and that drug. I'm going to share that based on my very own detailed experience according to the scripture of a Jesus story, so you know this is going to be a good one. But really not so good, but it's true. So if anyone ever wonders why an addict is so easily to go back to addiction, this is why. So the scripture I'm going to share is the unclean spirit. So before I end this part of the video, because I have to go to the laptop, I'm going to do a screen record so you can follow along with the words as I read them and explain them in full detail. So we're gonna do that now. I just want to make sure before I stop this recording on this part. I don't want this video to drag too much, but I do want to be very detailed. So before I move on to the scripture, I just want to I gotta remind everyone that if you're involved in drug addiction, okay, and you're still alive, there's still a chance. So I will bring you hope. I will share that throughout the video, but remember, no matter how deep you're in addiction, Jesus is the way out, okay? Pray to Jesus, read your Bible, and even if you're high, pray to him anyway. Even if it's hypocritical, who cares? Pray to him before, during, and after your relapse, each and every time. If you relapse and you stop praying, it will only get worse. But if you pray even in the middle of a relapse, as hypocritical that may sound, you may ease off this stuff and eventually give it up and turn to God. That's how I did it. I'll explain those things at some point. But there's still hope. Not everything's lost. Not everything's lost. So let's get to the scripture so you can better understand why people continuously relapse on addiction, in their addiction, which is another form of witchcraft and crack, heroin, and meth. Mine was crack cocaine, is a pure product of witchcraft. It's evil, and anytime anyone does these drugs, they are casting spells on themselves, whether they know it or not, and that is why people get paranoid. So with all that being said, hope I didn't forget anything. If I did, I'll just cut myself in to explain. All right, so let's do the scripture. All right, everybody, in this part, two or three of this video, I am going to, I'm going to explain when people in addiction is in their active addiction, they end up going to rehab to get clean for some time. Then when they get out of rehab with their freedoms back, they stay clean for some time, but later on down the road, eventually relapse in a lot of cases. Why this happens, I'm going to explain on the spiritual side of things why this happens based on my very own experience using a Jesus story in the book of, it is in the book of Matthew chapter 12, verses 43, I can't highlight that, 43 through 45, and I'm going to read all this. And then I'm going to go back verse by verse and explain in full detail what this means based on my very own experience when an unclean spirit leaves a man and returns, using myself as an example. So check this out. Remember, people, it's a Jesus story, so you hope I hope y'all like this. So let's get started. So in the book of Matthew, chapter 12, verses 43 through 45, I'm going to start reading. When an unclean spirit goes out of a man, he goes through dry places, seeking rest, and finds none. Then he says, I will return to my house from which I came. And when he comes, he finds it empty, swept, and put in order. Then he goes and takes with him seven other spirits, more wicked than himself. And they enter and dwell there. And the last state of that man is worse than the first state. So shall it also be with this wicked generation. Now, I'm going to go back and verse by verse, I'm going to explain how it worked, how this relates to me based on my very own experience. So, check this out. So, where it says, when an unclean spirit goes out of a man, me being that man, I'm using myself as an example, that spirit, he goes through dry places, seeks rest, and finds none. So, usually, whenever, so when I'm in my active addiction, like out on the streets and stuff, right? And then something happens. Something bad's always going to happen in addiction. We all know that. Listen, you either going to end up in jail or rehab. Unless it's death. That's an option too. I've almost been there. So I'm going to gonna use rehab as an example. So when I'm on the streets of my active addiction, something's gonna happen where I gotta go to rehab and get clean. So I do. And when I go to rehab, I get all cleaned up from the inside out. Maybe some exercise, eating healthy, catching up on sleep, not doing drugs, doing better things like learning stuff, good things. And I get cleaned up from the inside out. Okay. Then I will get released or, okay. So I'm doing all that getting clean. And that's why the unclean spirit leaves me once I go to rehab, because it'll mess with me later on when I have my freedoms back, whenever I get released from rehab, because the streets are dangerous. So while that demon or unclean spirit is roaming in the dry desert places looking for a place to rest, I'm in rehab getting clean. Then I get out of rehab and I'll stay clean for some time, maybe some weeks, some months, whatever. And at some point, that addiction is going to return to me. Because remember in the previous part of this video when I said these things, once you do their drugs, the product of witchcraft, they got you hooked like a fish. This is how they got you hooked like a fish, okay? So when someone's, let's say I'm like 6 months clean down the road, right? And I ain't thinking about stuff, so I'm still hooked like a fish, I just don't know. It's a trick of the evil one. They want you to think you got it, but you really don't, okay? Now listen, So whenever I'm out of a rehab, this is what this thing does. Then he says, this is demon talking to himself, basically. So in verse 44, it says, then he says, I will return to my house from which I came. And when he comes, he finds it empty, swept, and put in order. So this part here, when I was in rehab before the unclean spirit comes back later on in life, for a relapse to occur, I'll get there. When I was in rehab, I clean. Okay, where it says, okay, he finds me empty, swept, and put in order. This is because I cleaned myself up in rehab from the inside out, learned some stuff, got healthy, caught up on sleep, back in shape. And now the demon, it came back to check on me, say, hey, what's Jason doing, right? So it comes back and it sees that I'm living life, I'm happy, doing some good things. Well, evil spirits are evil, so they want to take that away from me and any other addict. So what happens, that evil spirit, next, once he sees that I'm all cleaned up and I have that void, anyone hear about that void they always be filling? I'll tell you what that is, stay tuned. So that void right there is an open space for these demons to come back. But before that unclean spirit returns back to make me relapse or influence me to relapse, he first goes out, where it says, then he goes and takes with him seven other spirits. Seven people, not just one, but seven other spirits, more wicked than himself. Okay? And they enter and dwell there. So that demon checked up on me after I got all cleaned up and I'm out of rehab doing good. And he wants to ruin it, the demon does. So he goes out, grabs his little buddy, seven of them, worse than him. And he invites them over to have a party up in my heart, people. Okay, to destroy me and to relapse again. So these, not only that first demon came back, but seven others. So I got like eight demons up in me now, right? And what they're gonna do, they're gonna mess with me with the mind. Because remember, addiction, the products of witchcraft, those street drugs, it still has their effect later, years down the road, people, and they can still mess with you on that. So now with eight evil spirits up in me, they gonna be like, let's mess with Jason. They're gonna give me thoughts, using dreams, triggers, wanting to use, urges. They're gonna bring people, places, and things back in my life. Anything they can do to slip me up. Why? Because they want me to. They want everyone to fall short of the Lord's glory. So they take our souls when we die. So, when those evil spirits come back, they enter me. And first, when I'm in addiction, active addiction, I'm bad. Then I get clean, okay? And the spirits leave. And then I'm back in with my freedoms, a little bit of clean time, then that one spirit brings back seven others with it, and it triggers me. And when I use, I am worse off the second time feeding my addiction than I ever was in my first time. So I'm bad in my first addiction, then I get clean, and then I relapse, and I'm worse, twice as worse than I was here. But you gotta remember, you got like eight demons instead of one now, so of course you're gonna be twice as worse. But every time I would get clean, whether rehab, jail, or whatever, when I go back to the addiction, a relapse, I just get worse and worse and worse and worse. And the reason why that, and that's just, and like Word says, and the last state of that man is worse than the first. So every time a relapse occurs, an addict usually gets worse and worse and worse and worse. That's because every time we put these products of witchcraft in us, street drugs, and performing witchcraft, we're just entertaining these demons more and we're letting them in our lives even more. So once that first relapse happens after being clean, it's just right back to the races, back to Doomland, walking ourselves into hell. That's what I did. Yep. So, and where it says, so shall it also be with this wicked generation. This is Jesus talking, this whole scripture. I sometimes wonder, was he talking about addiction? I think he was. But I'm pretty sure the unclean spirits, addiction is just one of many types. Okay? So with all that being said, the one thing I came to realize that I forgot to do every time I left the rehab, and people, I've been to more rehabs than you got fingers and toes combined, and that's not even counting jails and institutions. So I got some experience, and I know exactly what I'm talking about here, so check it. From my experience, this is what's going on. What I meant to say was, this is where I messed up coming out of rehab and going back to addiction. I didn't put Jesus Christ up in my heart. Okay, God and Jesus, I gotta put in my heart. In rehab, or even when I left rehab, I might have said it out loud that I did, but I wasn't walking in the faith, people. Not only do I have to accept Jesus Christ, we have to accept Jesus Christ, we also have to follow the will of the Father. There's two things. You have Jesus Christ and you don't follow God's will, you're gonna be a goat. And Jesus said to goats, depart from me. They didn't make it to heaven, they went to the other place. Don't be a goat, be a sheep who not only followed the ways of Jesus Christ and accepted him as Savior, but also followed his Father's will. As scripture says, okay, everyone who calls out in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ will be saved, but you gotta do a second thing. You gotta follow his Father's will, people. Okay, you gotta do both, not one or the other. You have to do both, follow the will and accept Jesus. So, because I said I did, but I wasn't following the Father's will, which led me right back to sin, those demons that came back, well, without God in your heart, without God and Jesus up in your heart, any demon can come up in your life and mess with you. Now the demons are in the heart. But when I found out, when you come out of rehab and you not only say you accept Jesus Christ and you're going to try to follow the Father's will to the best you can, when you really try it, mean it, and you truly give your heart to Jesus Christ, Jesus and God are up in your heart now. So when the demon, okay, so if you come out of rehab or you get clean, even with or without a rehab, don't matter. If you put Jesus Christ up in your heart, he gonna put that's God, that's like putting God up in you. So going to rehab and you clean yourself up and you sweep all this stuff out, just like scripture says, where it says, he finds it empty, swept and put in order. Do all that stuff in rehab or however you get clean, whether you get clean at home or wherever, do all that, sweep your stuff, get yourself back in shape. So when you got that void going on, don't forget to put Jesus Christ there, because if you don't, these demons will always come back to mess with you, just like in scripture. And you don't want that demon to bring buddies like seven other evil spirits. That's hard to stay clean with those living up in your heart. So without Jesus Christ in our heart, we ain't shit. We're gonna be doomed by addiction. He's the only one who could save us. You better get that right. Nobody gets to the Father except through Jesus Christ, just as scripture says so. So read it and weep, my friend. That's the truth. I'm living proof. I guarantee that's the truth. So listen, you put Jesus Christ up in your heart when you get clean, okay? You're going to fight these triggers, these urges, the one thing to use, it's going to get easier. I'm not saying it's going to be easy in the beginning, but you get into good practice, praying to God and Jesus, reading that Bible, and truly doing all those things in your heart. You're putting God and Jesus up in your heart. So when those demons come back to mess with you, when you clean later on down the road, they're going to see God and Jesus up in your heart. You know what those demons are going to do when they see Jesus up in your heart? They're going to scam. They're going to scram. They're leaving. They don't want no part of Jesus. They're scared of him. because he's the only one. See, Jesus' name is so powerful, even the demons flee from him. They scared of that, because Jesus is powerful. That's who your supermodel should be. That's mine. Okay. So that's pretty much how that works. Anyone can get clean. They can put any program up in their life. They can do whatever. You fill in that void, that's because God ain't there. That's that void, by the way. Okay. So there's three things to do. I'm going to say this real quick. Okay. So we work out and we eat to, you know, keep our physical bodies in shape. Okay. We might read a book or educate ourselves or learn something to keep our mentality in shape. Okay. What do we do for the spirit? What do we do for our souls? Not too many people know. I'll tell you what you do for your soul. Put your hands together, pray to Jesus Christ, and you ask for forgiveness, and you refrain from sin, repent from sin, and you read your Bible so you can learn the will of the Father and follow that. Because you got to have Jesus and follow the Father's will all at the same time. You get Jesus just by talking to him. That's how you form a relationship. Do it on a daily basis as much as you can throughout the day. And then follow the Father's will. Read the Bible to learn the Father's will. I can't teach you. I can show bits and pieces. But read the Bible and you'll be well on your way. And then when those demons come back to return to you, it's going to be like, whatever. I messed this video up. I really did.